Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. My guest tonight is the director of a film that's opening on August 15th. The film is Crazy Rich Asians. The director, my guest, Jon M. Chu.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
I've seen Crazy Rich Asians. It's a fun, funny, and at times touching romantic comedy. And for the first time in more than two decades for a major studio film, it's a film with an all-Asian cast.
The studios are feeling the pressure and they need an answer. So when we walk in the room, say, hey, we have an answer for you. You want to know one thing you can do is get behind this movie. Market this movie. Not just letting it out and just to put a press release out, but you push it. I promise you the message is we are worth your time. We are worth you spending $15 at the ticket counter, the $20 at the food thing, finding parking, sitting in a dark room and say, tell me a great story. We are worth your time. Yeah. And for 25 years, the message has been we're not worth that time.
My conversation with director Jon M. Chu when we come back. Jon, it's great to have you back on Frank Buckley Interviews.
Oh, it's great to be here. I mean, it's upgraded everything. This is beautiful.
We're on TV now.
You've moved in. It's awesome. Yeah, I know. It's awesome.
Congratulations on Crazy Rich Asians.
Thank you.
As you know, I had a chance to go to a screening ahead of the opening, and I had a smile on my face, and it's a romantic comedy in a classic way.
Rich, we've been dating for over a year now, and I think it's about time people met my beautiful girlfriend. What about us taking an adventure east?
Like Queens?
Singapore, Colin's wedding. Don't you want to be my family?
And it just, I don't want to give away the ending, but it's a feel-good film. Mm-hmm. How do you feel at this point, the film is just getting to audiences. Yeah. How do you feel right now?
It's a relief, to be honest. It's been a long journey. The choice to, tap on my ethnicity, which I have never told in my stories before. Not that I'm ashamed of it, but I was scared to touch on it. It's so personal to me. And to actually fight that fight, get it into a Hollywood studio, Warner Brothers, the first Hollywood studio film with an all-Asian cast in 25 years.
25 years.
Mm-hmm. To push that through, to get that made, to have them spending money on marketing and actually make a movie that is joyful and beautiful, and I've been getting great reactions, means a lot, and that my family is proud of. It's been a whirlwind, and I'm just excited for people to experience it, because I think whether you're Asian or not, everyone has a crazy family, and you're going to really love, I think, the journey that we take you on.
Mom, this is Rachel Chu.
She just thinks you're some, like, unrefined banana.
No, those are for your fingers.
Yellow on the outside, or white on the inside. Do some crazy!
I chose to raise a family. For me, it was a privilege. But for you, you may think it's old-fashioned.
Don't you want Nick to be happy?
I know you're not what Nick needs.
And that's the one thing, part of why I was smiling as I watched the film, because it's an all-Asian cast, and because that hasn't happened in a generation,
yeah,
right? Mm-hmm. 25 years is a generation.
Yeah.
And I think that people who watch this film, you don't have to be Asian to appreciate it. Yes, there are a few Asian sort of inside jokes.
Yes.
But it's a film that I think after the first minute, you forget that it's an all-Asian cast. Mm-hmm. And I suspect that's by design.
Yeah, I mean, that's something, honestly, that came a surprise to me, really. I mean, this is not, even though it's called Crazy Rich Asians, it's not about being crazy, it's not about being rich, it's not about Asians. It's about human beings.
Yeah.
And making the movie, of course, we know the challenges of going into it and casting and getting a studio to agree. But when we were actually making the movie, we knew that this is about storytelling, about a woman's journey going through the sort of gauntlet of her dual cultural identity, of following the man that she loves and learning how to sacrifice, so it's been cool to sort of go through that as well. So,
take me into the executive suites when you're trying to push this movie through, and you're, you know, it is all Asian. It's based on this successful book, Crazy Rich Asians.
Yep.
And they obviously are interested in the subject matter. And up until now, when you try, I'm not saying you, but when one would try to sell a film that stars Asians, is about an Asian story, studios say what to you or to other filmmakers?
Before, that conversation doesn't even start. Like, you're not getting in that room. There's so many things that they say that, you know, oh, this stuff won't travel. Oh, this isn't, domestic audiences won't be interested in this. But you know, the difference is the people out there. Social media has really changed the landscape. When it changed my brain, actually. Several years ago, I was finishing up a movie and reading all this stuff about Ghost in the Shell and Whitewashed Out and all these things where people actually had a voice and could speak it. Usually, you sort of keep it to yourself. For the first time, people were fighting back. And I was reading this from Constance Wu, from Daniel Day Kim. So all these people, Alan Yang. And realizing, yeah, this is actually really true. I had kept it inside, but to hear people say it, it changes you. And then I would say, well, what is Hollywood doing about this? This is so crazy. And then looking at myself in the mirror being like, oh, I am Hollywood. Like, I've been in this business. I've only done studio movies. Do I actually have the power to help this in any way? And then realizing, yeah, I earned this position. If I actually put all my energy into it, I probably get one movie that I can just like push through the relationships. And so I went on a search for what that movie would be, and I read Crazy Rich Asians as a recommendation from my family, and it said everything I wanted to say without being my own personal story of an Asian American going to Asia for the first time. This can, again, you don't have to be Asian to understand that. If you're going, doing your birthright in Israel and you go through that experience and coming back home and this dual identity, that's the beauty of America, that you're not just one of these things. So going into those rooms with this in hand, one, we got great producers, Nina Jacobson and Brad Simpson, John Panatti. Going into those rooms, social media has done a lot of work for us. The studios are feeling the pressure and they need an answer. So when we walk in the room, say, hey, we have an answer for you. You want to know one thing you can do is get behind this movie. Market this movie, not just letting it out and just to put a press release out, but you push it. I promise you the message is we are worth your time. We are worth you spending $15 at the ticket counter, the $20 at the food thing, finding parking, sitting in a dark room and say, tell me a great story. We are worth your time. Yeah. And for 25 years, the message has been, we're not worth that time. Mm. At least for the Asian American side of it. Of course, there's been Chinese stories, Chinese things, but that doesn't relate to us as Americans, as us sort of this dual identity. So that's what I think. It's so important to speak up.
And as a director, you have so many decisions to make.
Yeah.
And so many pressures that you're carrying through this period of time from pre-production to production and post-production and now selling the film. And added to the usual pressures of storytelling and all of those other things is this layer of, hey, John, you're doing something that's very important to the Asian American community. Do you feel that weight as you're making the film?
Yes, for sure. But I guess I feel more from my parents and my brothers and sisters being like, don't mess this one up, dude.
Really?
More than the rest of the world. Maybe when you have personal connections, it's a lot stronger than that. Of course, you feel the weight of social media. I've been on the side where social media attacks you. I've been on the side where they support you. So I know the dangers of that. I've also had experience working with fan bases like the Justin Bieber fan base, when we never say never, and they have certain things they hold on to that you need to stay true to, and other things that they don't know that is so amazing about this person that you want to bring to the surface. So I think I was built for this movie, actually. In all my experiences leading up to this, I grew thick skin. I've learned how to work with studios, to fight the fights, when to fight the fights, when to put my foot down, and also that all that stuff actually doesn't matter in the end of the day. We are storytellers. We're making a movie, and people go to movies to be entertained, to escape their life, and to also know that they're not alone in their struggle. Like, everyone feels lonely, everyone feels out of place, everyone's trying to find how they fit into this crazy world. And movies say, we're all in that struggle together, and that's what makes it a beautiful world. So that's what we really focused on in making this movie, and that relieved a lot of the stress. I'm more stressed now than I was making the movie, because I think that the importance of people showing up that weekend is beyond just our little movie. It's about, if financially it does well in that opening weekend, it greenlights four other movies that are on the line, maybe more than that, that every studio has, but they haven't greenlit yet because they want to see if the proof is in the pudding and that financially it makes sense. then we will get more stories than just this one to rely everything on, to rely every story on, to rely a whole experience on. There's a lot of better filmmakers than me. There are a lot better stories than this one. And the bigger picture is people show up that weekend. It's the door cracks open for better, greater stories to come down that line.
I met a girl, I fell in love, and I want to marry her.
You're Nicholas Young, you're untouchable. But Rachel's not.
Have you prepped Rachel to face the wolves?
You know I'm back, like I never left.
I really admire you. It takes guts coming all the way over here, facing Nick's family.
Another day, another breath.
I know this much. You will never be enough.
One thing that I loved in watching Crazy Rich Asians is, you know, you have faces like yours, faces mm-hmm. like mine. You know, mm-hmm. I'm half Asian. Mm-hmm. Your lead character, your lead male, Henry Golding.
Damn, Rachel. It's like the Asian Bachelor. Mm-hmm.
In fact, as I watched Henry, I thought, why didn't John call me? I could have at least auditioned.
We did. You never called us back. I don't understand.
But it's nice to see faces reflected on the screen that are three-dimensional because, yeah. as you know, forever, Asians have been portrayed as the villains, mm-hmm. the punchline, mm-hmm. the nerd. It never in any sort of lead or heroic sort of place or three-dimensional. And I think that your film has all of them, all of the above. It's, you have the smart, the not so smart, the mm-hmm. funny, the not so funny. Just like life.
Just like life.
These people aren't just rich, they're crazy rich.
You really should have told me that you're like the Prince William of Asia.
That's ridiculous. Much more of a Harry.
And you had to be conscious of that as you were creating these characters. And
yeah, that was the main thing for me was Asian American going to Asia for the first time. We're not just one bunch of people. There are complicated dynamics that deal with class, culture, gender.
You know, it's about time someone stood up to Auntie Eleanor. Well, you, not me. Oh, God. She can't know I was ever here.
I feel glorious, glorious. Got a chance to start again. I was born for this, born for this.
Ever since I can remember, my family has been my whole life.
Rachel! Rachel!
If Nick chose me, he would lose his family. And if he chose his family, he might spend the rest of his life resenting you.
You nasty. You got a nasty. You got nastier.
When you have a cast full of Asians, you're not dependent on one cliche version of an Asian to represent us all. You get a whole menagerie of people. You get the new money you get the sensitive best friend, you get the mom that actually isn't a villain in the end of the day. Like,
yeah.
When we asked Michelle Yeoh, who is a legend and so excited to work with, we were pitching it to her and she's like, if you want me to play a villain, I'm not going to be in this movie. She's like, this is my culture, these are my people, I wouldn't be able to go home mm-hmm. if I was just arch and just trying to destroy this woman. But I can tell you from my perspective of if an American were to come into my family, what I would be most worried about is, you know, Americans are taught to follow their dreams and go after their passions. And it's all about yourself. Just as long as you're happy, then the world is good. And she's like, where we is like, sacrifice your happiness for the good of the family. And I know, I understand that dynamic. It's not even an Asian thing. I think it's an all a family thing of people who've come from other places to America understand that dynamic, that now we are tasked, our responsibility as a new generation is to, and even beyond younger generation, is to pass on what our cultural priorities are. Mm-hmm. And so some things from the Chinese Asian culture are worth keeping. Some things may be a little bit questionable. And some things in the American culture are worth saving. And some things are a little bit questionable. And we're creating this world humanity. And so I love painting the picture that that this next generation is going to have to make those choices. It's almost too late for me to make those choices, but we can lay those things out and how we teach our children. I just had my first baby, so that was very much on my on my brain about what do I want to pass on to her.
Yeah,
so.
You've told me this story before, but I want to share it with the viewing audience. Here you are, this accomplished director and producer today. Mm-hmm. A few years ago, you were just coming out of USC.
Yep,
and your first pitch, I think, is with Steven Spielberg.
Yes.
And tell us how that happened, and then tell me how the pitch went.
So it was, I think back and I cringe a little bit, but I made a short film at USC called When the Kids Were Away. Princess Grace Foundation gave me this grant to do this movie. So I did it, and it's a big musical about mothers. And so Steven Spielberg somehow got, this is before YouTube, before like internet video was really around. It was, so it's only on DVD or VHS.
Right.
He got a copy somehow, and he called me up on a Friday.
First of all, when he calls, do you think, who's punking me, or do you know this is Steven Spielberg?
Well, my agent called me right before saying, hey, rumor has it that Steven Spielberg saw your short. Don't know if that means anything or if he, you know, if it's fake, but just know that that happened. So don't think about it all weekend. So all weekend I'm like, what? What does that mean? Did he hate it? Does that? And then you get the call on that Saturday afternoon, and then you're like, oh, it's real. Here he is. And he wanted to meet right away, so we met on that Monday. We had like a 2 hour, maybe 2.5 hour conversation about musicals, cinema, USC, because he's a huge supporter at USC. And at the end of it, my goal was like, I just wanted a second meeting with Steven Spielberg. So going into there, I was like, how do I get a second meeting? So in that conversation, I was like, oh, and you know, I have this other musical that I'm working on. And he's like, oh, what's that? I was like, oh, I can tell you on Thursday if you want. He's like, that sounds great. So I went back to my apartment where my best friend and his wife were working on a musical that we had been talking about. So I was like, hey, how would you guys want to pitch this to Steven Spielberg on Thursday? They're like, that's in 4 days, dude. So we stayed up all night for those 4 days, got a bunch of our friends to help write music and things like that. And then when we went in to pitch, I'd never pitched in my life. So we're like, I don't know how to pitch. So we went in with a chest full of costumes and wigs. And all these cardboard cutout images. So we're telling the story, and it's Steven Spielberg, it's Adam Goodman, who eventually became the president of Paramount, Mike DeLuca, who's a huge producer now, and Walter and Laurie, who are running DreamWorks at the time. So it's just them and us, and we pull out wigs and things, and we're literally acting out scenes from this musical, and it's like an hour pitch, like Moulin Rouge, like da 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 da, da. And by the end, just every images, costumes are everywhere, and their jaws are like wide open. They're like, wow. I think they said you guys need to teach a class in pitching. Wow. I don't know if they're being facetious. Looking back, I'm like, wait a minute. But we felt very proud. And then as we're walking to the parking lot, he stops us, Steven, with his wife, and he's like, "This is these guys who just pitched to us, and they bought it a week later."
That's wonderful. On just one more sort of punctuation, yeah. Or one more question to follow up on that. I know Bye Bye Birdie was supposed to be your first film,
yes,
out of SC.
Yes,
it didn't get made. Now you're a big shot director and producer who can make anything he wants. Is that going to happen?
We'll see. I don't know. I think they're doing a live version with J-Lo. And my version was very different. We were modernizing and doing a thing. I loved it. I still love it. I think in time, that would be a great full circle thing to do. But as of now, I think the rights are sort of tied up, and we'll see. And I'm doing my first musical this summer. My first, I love musicals. I love dance stuff and music stuff. So I've been waiting to find the perfect musical to do as my first musical movie. And of course, I've worked with Lin-Manuel Miranda, the king, the god, for his musical In the Heights. And we're shooting that in Washington Heights in New York City next summer. So I'm very excited about that.
What's it like to work with such a force like him? Because you're both creative guys.
Yep.
Both headstrong, and you have your vision of what this should be. That's a recipe for either wonderful things happening or complete disaster.
It's true. I think the wonderful thing about someone like Lin, who's confident in his abilities and his storytelling, he doesn't need to force himself on you. He's there for you. He also understands that film is a different medium than stage, and that the show couldn't just be translated and just straight up translated into a movie, that you actually have to make big story changes and break it a little bit without losing the spirit of it to make a better movie. and a reason why to make a movie instead of just filming the stage show. So he's been super collaborative in letting me do my thing, but also stepping in when he thinks, hey, by the way, this is really important to our audience. Hey, this moment always got the audience to laugh. Oh, this moment when this song is very important. So as we sift through all that, he's been a great collaborator. And of course, he motivates you every day. I mean, look at his tweets every morning, every night. He's like, it's like working with The Rock, where like you just feel like you can do anything when you're around them.
Ah, great. Well, John, I'm so happy for you, so Thank proud you. Of you. Crazy Rich Asians is something that I hope everyone will see.
Me too.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks to Jon M. Chu for a terrific conversation. If you'd like to hear the entire uncut version of our chat, go to the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast, available wherever you listen to podcasts, including Google Play and iTunes and on the KTLA News app. If you'd like to give us some feedback on Frank Buckley Interviews, tag me on social media. I'm Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and Instagram, and there's a Frank Buckley Facebook page as well. And if you want to share the TV show with your friends around the world, tell them to check us out on YouTube. We post the show there, and you can find it by searching for Frank Buckley Interviews. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.